And welcome to Liberty Under Attack Radio, your home for anarchism in action. I'm your host, Shane. Liberty Under Attack is covered by a BIPCOT, no government license. This allows reuse and modification by anyone, except for governments and the agents thereof. You can learn more at BIPCOT.org. In just a moment, you will hear part 2 of 3 of my interview with Kyle Rearden regarding his Right to Travel series. If you haven't caught our introduction, part 1, you should probably do that first, as this is a series. In this edition, we will cover the infringements on right to travel and what the hell happened in Texas to make those a reality. Kyle also lets us know whether said infringements are unconstitutional, constitutional, or extra-constitutional. But first, I have a couple quick announcements. First off, the Vonnie podcast has been launched. At this time, there is one podcast available, but one other one will be available early this week. Make sure to visit the website, vonniepodcast.com, and find the show on iTunes, Stitcher, or TuneIn Radio. Secondly, we have gotten our first sponsor, and I'd like to tell you a bit about them real quick. I've mentioned on the show before that I struggled for months to find the NCAP flag that you may have seen when we did the live show. Some other stores have sprung up attempting to fill this market demand, but I have yet to find my go-to outlet that offers both great quality and affordable prices. That is, until now. AncapStore.com is your home for tons of great anarchist merch, ranging from flags, t-shirts, all the way to bracelets. There's certainly something for everyone. And even better, if you pay in Bitcoin, you can get 5% off any order. Orders over $25 also come with free shipping. For real, guys, there's some great stuff on this site. The extremely popular ANCAP Gadsden, and my personal favorite, their Pledge Defiance Voluntary shirt, which is on sale now. Surely a conversation starter. And through Valentine's Day, you can get an additional 10% off your entire order when you use the coupon code LibertyUnderAttack, all one word. So, what are you waiting for? Go to ancapstore.com today. Again, that is ancapstore.com, and make sure to tell them Shane sent you. And that's all I have for you. Since this podcast will be damn near 2 hours, and that's all our networks will give us, I will not return for closing thoughts afterwards. I'll provide those once the series is concluded come Thursday. Please enjoy. So, part one, Kyle, we've gone through the introduction, kind of laid out some of the philosophical sort of, you know, arguments for or against right to travel, and you kind of explained your reasoning for using argumentation ethics to, you know, justify those concepts. But let's get more into, you know, the meat of the discussion here. So, what are the infringements against the right to travel?
The short list, which of course we'll go into more detail because some of this does need to be explained. Again, this is all original research and, you know, people can kind of follow along in the most of the entirety of the series from extra-constitutional number 1 all the way up to extra-constitutional number 6, I believe. But the infringements briefly listed are driver licensure, vehicle registration, emissions inspections, liability certification. This includes the auto insurance, but there's other things involved and we'll get to that. Traffic stops and general funding. So that's the list of the infringements in question. And obviously we'll go through each one.
Indeed. So I kind of want to start out with, I've written about these before, but my two police encounters in 2015, about 3 months apart, I got really unlucky that year. And I got called for jury summons around that same time. So yeah, last year was a little hellish and a lot of state involvement, not voluntarily, by the way. so I guess just a quick summary of what happened to me. One here was in Bloomington for expired registration and driving out insurance. I had insurance, I just didn't have, you know, my insurance card, proof of insurance. And the other one was on the way to a Freedom Festival. You know, that's kind of odd, right, Kyle?
Ironic, yeah.
Ironic. Yeah, I was on the way to the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. And that one was total fucking bullshit. And I'll use that vernacular here because it really was. It was, I wrote reports on both of those. And if you want to find those, you can just go to libertyunderattack.com. And scroll down to the categories section and go to Adventures in Illinois Law. Or if you go to the just libertyunderattack.com, under the home tab, I do have Adventures in Illinois Law there, so you can find them that way if you're interested in reading the reports. But it was like midnight on a Friday night. And I was with the girl that I went up there with, and you know, here, so I guess put some context here in Illinois. If you can see the like at if you can see like when you're going from the right lane to left lane to pass, when you return to the right lane, as long as you can see both of the headlights and the passenger mirror, you're good to change back. So that's what I did then. But apparently they have a different law in Michigan, and the law that he read, I was definitely when it's not breaking, but I think it was a DUI check. But anyways, there's a lot of profiling that happened in both of those stops, especially the one, you know, at midnight with that jackass cop. Yeah. Anyways, yeah, definitely profiling. So those are kind of my, you know, two police encounters. Definitely, you know, feared for my life, as you kind of mentioned in the introduction, Kyle. It's not a comfortable situation to be in.
No, absolutely not. And, you know, I've had my own encounters, which I'll mention as we go through the different infringements. But yeah, the ones that you just mentioned regarding your own different situations, they sound more like the so-called moving violations, which are distinguished from the non-moving violations or the paperwork crimes, right?
Yeah, that first one was a paperwork crime. Yeah.
Oh, okay. My correction then. Correction. You actually did have one of one and one of the other, right? A non-moving and a moving violation, right? Okay, so same as me then. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So whether it's the paperwork crime, do you have your papers? May I see your papers, please? There is that. And most of the extra constitutional series is actually focused more on that. But there's also the moving violations, which is, you know, basically actually using the privately owned automobile traveling on the roads, and that they didn't like you and how you were moving, hence moving violation and such. Yeah. So let's kind of go through these one by one. So the first article was extra constitutional number one: are Texans required to become licensed drivers? I think the opening quote is probably good enough to at least summarize a lot of the article. This is from the court case Callas versus State. Callas is spelled C-A-L-L-A-S, number 30094. This was a case that was adjudicated in 1959. And just to remind people, you can follow along in each of these articles, as well as for the entire extra constitutional series, the Right to Travel bibliography, which has all of the original sources available for free download. So in Callas versus State, it said, quote, "This court has held that there is no such license known to Texas law as a driver's license," close quote. So think about that. 1959, no such thing as driver's license. It's like, wait a minute. I have a driver's license. At least I think I do. Wait, I need to investigate this. What the hell happened? I'm confused. I need a clear answer. So let me just mention some things here. You know, as was kind of mentioned in the overview or introduction, you know, a lot of people are affected by this, by these right to travel infringements. And according to the Federal Highway Administration, you know, there were 2.7 million licensed Texas drivers in 1950. So there's no such thing in the law at that time, 1959, as a driver's license, but there were 2.7 licensed Texas drivers in 1950, 9 years prior. So there's your first problem. So why do you have 2.7 million people who have a driver's license when even the Texas judiciary themselves said, you don't need a driver's license?
Yeah, that's kind of interesting, right?
Yeah, that's a problem. Now, the FHA, the Federal Highway Administration, also revealed that in 2010, so this would be, 2010 was what, 7, 8 years ago, something like that, there were 15.1 million licensed Texas drivers. So 2.7 in 1950, when you didn't need a driver's license apparently, but they did it anyway, to 15.1 million today, where, as I'll get to in a moment, then you didn't before and the laws changed, but how did that happen? And why is this even taught in the public schools? You think they would, but they don't. Because, of course, and like many teenagers are familiar with, like getting their learner's permit, it's almost like a rite of passage, right?
Oh, yeah.
You get the learner's permit, and that leads you to the driver's license. It's the closest thing to a cultural rite of passage. Parents know what I'm talking about. And so, but as a matter of law, as a matter of legality, what does, just objectively, take your own ideology and preferences for a free world or even an enslaved world, statism or such, either way, put it aside for the moment, just objectively, let's look at the law and see what the law says. And that was the idea behind this series. So between 1946 and 1959, the Court of Criminal Appeals of Texas, side note, there are two Supreme Courts in Texas. There is the Texas Supreme Court, which handles civil matters, and there's the other Supreme Court of Texas, which handles criminal matters. That Supreme Court is called the Court of Criminal Appeals. And all of these court cases I'm mentioning, unless I make an exception, all of these court cases are from the Court of Criminal Appeals, the equivalent of the Texas Supreme Court for the criminal side. I know, it's state government, man. I can't make this stuff up. So between 1946 and 1959, the Court of Criminal Appeals of Texas consistently ruled that there is no such thing as a driver's license anywhere within Texan law. I then take the next good chunk of the article and basically go through different examples and do excerpts and such. Just one of those being, of course, Callis, like I already mentioned. Now, there was a statute that was being interpreted regarding, well, is it an operator's license or a driver's license? And to normal people, yes, that kind of does sound like a semantics thing. But remember, with legalese, with lawyers, it actually isn't. Words, legal words have to mean things, and the meanings have to be very precise, because the entire rulings of cases, regardless of the subject matter, even if we were talking about something completely different as a legal matter, makes the difference between whether it goes with whether the ruling it goes for in favor of one party versus another. So actually the meanings of words legally actually do matter. That's why lawyers spend a lot of time on it, or at least some of them do.
That's why they get paid the big bucks, right?
Yeah, so don't even get me started on court costs. although actually we will have to talk about that in an hour or so, but whatever. These rulings by the Texas appellate judiciary were fundamentally based upon something called Vernon's Annotated Civil Statutes, VACS. I'm going to repeat that again because people need to know this, because this is, we're getting closer to the genesis, the origin of where this crap came from. Vernon's Annotated Civil Statutes, VACS. And to make this even more confusing, although I don't mean it to, they're also called Vernon's Civil Statutes and Vernon's Texas Statutes. So any of those three terms, Vernon's Annotated Civil Statutes, Vernon's Civil Statutes, or Vernon's Texas Statutes, three different names for the same body of statutory law that was passed by the legislature here, okay? So that's just lovely.
Yeah,
so,
fun stuff.
Yeah, so good luck trying to find the law about anything. But anyway, if you're trying to trace it back to the source about like what the legislature actually did regarding any subject matter. See, and see, there's also some people might suggest that there might be potential due process issues, or if not due process, issues of how can you even do the legal research to find out what the law says about any legal matter, not just what we're talking about tonight. It's like,
No shit. Because last year, and I acquired your assistance in this, but when I was, my jury summons, I wanted to know if I was actually required to like go and do that. Mm-hmm. And, I found out a couple of things, but I figured out about 50% of it, but the other 50% I couldn't figure out. And I said, I don't want to go to jail. I'll just go do this. So even like, I spent a lot of, that was the first legal research I really ever did. And, I was, completely unable to find, not completely, but mostly unable to find what I needed. It's they don't make it easy.
Well, you were trying to look up state law, not the federal laws of any one kind, like a United States code, right? You were looking at I think it was the ILCS.
Yep, Illinois Compiled Statutes. Yep.
Right. And technically, as I'm going to get to here, the statute, the recodified body of statutory law or statutory code is the Texas Transportation Code. And most of the extraconstitutional series focuses on the TTC. The problem, though, is that I'll leave that up to the listeners. I don't want to make up their minds for them necessarily. I'll just say this. The TTC is a rephrased version of what the legislature itself passed. And see, now you automatically have a problem right off the bat. Automatically. And that's not limited to right to travel issues or infringements. This is anything in Texas state law, anything, bankruptcies, divorce, whatever. Even that you're mentioning your jury duty. Yeah, that too. anything.
So they kind of reacquired like all the power. They acquired.
They reworded it. So let me put it this way: in a Republican form of government, you have your three branches of government. One of those is the legislature, right? The legislatures write bills, and if they vote on it, do their little ritual of passing bills into law, it becomes law, right? And it's signed by the governor.
Mm-hmm.
So it mimics the federal government. That was kind of the idea, right? Right. State governments mimic them. Okay, whatever. So you would think that whatever the legislature wrote and legislated and brought into being through their rituals would be the state law, correct? Or at least on the, the statute would be the statutes, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the executive would enforce them and the judiciary would interpret it when it goes to court and such. Okay, you would think that, but no. What they actually did, and sorry, I'm having to explain all this background because a lot of this other stuff won't make any sense. What they actually did in 1995 was that the VACS, which is actually the actual enabling statutes, what the legislature actually said what the law is, the state law is. There was a in 1995. There's, and I do mention this in several of the extra constitutional articles over and over again. But the revisers' reports, those were and those people that were behind that were explaining about how they were rephrasing the laws and rephrasing it in order to make the modern contemporary TTC, which is actually enforced by the government police, what I was coercively subjected to, as I'll get to with my own case, with my own, my own experiences. So they actually rephrased it and reworded it. So it's not the exact wording. So is there corruption at play? I think so. Maybe other people would disagree with me about that, but what I can say objectively is that they completely changed the wording. So there's your first, and of course, here's my favorite part. The revisers, the whole justification in the different revisers reports back in 1995 when this change happened was to, well, we just want to simplify the state laws. So we're going to completely rewrote everything the legislature actually passed into law.
And then they're probably longer too, are they?
They're somewhat longer, but here's the problem. I think the evidence shows that what the legislature passed tells, it's still a sad story in a sense in terms of our liberties, but it's also a different story too. And so let's try and finish up this driver's license one, because there's a lot to get to. So I had to explain that, because that's kind of like an underlying issue that goes beyond right to travel. It's just even like, is the law there, the government police are enforcing even the law? Because a lot of them don't even know this. Because do you think your average, Texas police officer, municipal, county, or state level government, do you think any of them are doing all this legal research about the laws that they're about the traffic laws that they're enforcing vis-a-vis the TTC?
No, for sure. No, definitely not.
As best as I can tell, most of the lawyers who get paid lots and lots of money that, well, I'm not an attorney, I don't play one on TV, but I'm doing work that they haven't, at least a lot of them.
Yeah.
And I would challenge any attorney, and I would say specifically the Texas ones, because my legal research is limited to that. I would challenge any Texas attorney to go through my articles and embarrass the living hell out of me publicly by saying, hey, I'm a little off base here, and oh, you misunderstood something, the law actually means this. Please let everybody know, because you know the benefit of that? They would actually have to actually talk about this crap.
Yeah.
About what actually happened here. Anyway, let's get back to some of the substance here. And again, please, for the listeners, keep in mind, there's only so much I can mention here in terms of time. So this is more of like an overview of an overview of an overview. It's just, this is highly condensed, but I did want to spend some time mentioning about the VACS. So whatever is the law might not actually be the law, but then sometimes is, and good luck figuring it out. Anywho, so I'm going to skip a little bit here in the driver's license article. Basically, here's the short version. The Texas legislature originally required the licensure of those who made their livelihoods off of using the public roads. And they were called chauffeurs, and it was for profit. It would be people like, so people who, think of like taxi drivers or semi-truck drivers, or again, chauffeurs, like limousines, right? So like those are the only guys that originally had to get a license of any kind. And at that time, it was called a chauffeur's license. Legally speaking, that was what the term was. But then over time, hold on. But then they broadened the scope of licensure quite a lot in 1935. And so then there was a operator's license. Now you have an operator's license and a chauffeur's license. And then they broadened it yet again in 1941. So now you have three different ones. You now have a chauffeur's license, an operator's license, and a commercial operator's license. So you have this further distinguishing out. But then everything really kind of goes into a cockhead pretty much by the time you get to, about 1948 or so after the war. Because, hold on, the language in the 1948 edition of the VACS is that that's the actual enabling, like the real actual statutory law. The VACS is noticeably dissimilar from that, from what the 1995 revisers report claimed the source law said it was, which itself is considered to be the basis for the revised law. Oh yeah, that was the other thing too. In the revisers report, when they changed everything, when they say source law, they're talking about like what the legislature actually did, what they actually said, the rituals and all that. The revised law, that's other people coming along later in 1995, rewriting, rephrasing what the legislature had done earlier.
So, and that's kind of the basis for, you know, these infringements that you see in Texas
nowadays.
Well, to be fair,
the legislature was also doing infringements too, because in the extraconstitutional series, I look at both sides. I look at the Texas Transportation Code, the revised law according to the revisers reports, and I look at the VACS. I look at both.
Okay.
So I can compare and contrast, so I can figure out what that. I'm trying to be objective here, at least in terms of doing the actual legal research, especially with people who happen to disagree with me, right, with my conclusions, of course. So at least there's, you know, just the facts, ma'am. Well, good investigative journalism, too. You know, just the facts, and then we can debate, like, you know, make value judgments about it, right? So I figured, just in the interest of objectivity, do both the TTC and the VACS. And sometimes they are consistent, to be perfectly frank. The legislature actually did do some bad stuff. But then there's other times where they're playing these little word games, as the case here with the driver licensure, where essentially the Court of Criminal Appeals, and so now we're going to the judicial branch, was basically saying that it was, and it was different cases. Sometimes in some of the cases, the police would screw up on actually like writing the tickets, or prosecutors would screw up on like the information or the charges against the defendants by saying that, well, he had to have a driver's license, and the court, and then the judges would say, well, the statutes technically say, again, chauffeur's license, operator's license, commercial operator's license, but no driver's license. You say driver's license, the statute doesn't say driver's license, therefore he goes free. And that happened over and over and over and over and over again. Which was funny, because like after like the first three, four, five times it happened, the cops were still pulling people over and arresting them, and they had to go to court yet again. So this happened over and over and over between 1946 and 1959.
A little bit of a power trip, eh?
Let me put it this way, and I'm kind of, now this is my own analysis personally, but I honestly think it might be reasonable to conclude that maybe perhaps there was a power struggle of some kind between the legislative branch and the, because remember, this was before 1995, so the whole revision thing hadn't happened yet, between the legislative branch and the judicial branch. The legislature wanted to do all these central planning bureaucratic type controls, at least regarding the driver licensure, but the judiciary was kind of acting as a rear guard, saying, no, Texans don't have to do this crap, because you screwed up on the terminology. You see how that works?
Mm-hmm.
So you basically have one group of lawyers, the legislature, trying to say central planning, and then you have the other lawyers, the judges on the CCA, basically saying, no, you screwed up on the phrasing. We're not going to rule against these defendants. Let him go. And they did. Whether it was Hines
or
other
people.
I don't think
that's worthy of commendation per se, because, you know, they're just doing their damn job. Like that's what they're probably supposed to do.
Well, I guess that might be a fair retort, and quite possibly that is true. But also consider the time period. You know, most of these cases were happening in the 40s and 50s. So I know some people are nostalgic about how wonderful the 50s were, and it's like, well, I don't know. I mean, the judiciary was kind of ruling on behalf of these defendants, at least a lot of them, of the ones I've, you know, cited in the article. And in the bibliography and such. But then again, the cops were also harassing them at the same time, and there were prosecutors trying to put these people behind bars and or fine them and just do other things. Right, it was criminal offenses against the state.
Yeah.
And so basically the long and short of it is that regarding today, like the current laws and such. And I'm trying to see if I can pull this up pretty quickly here. But generally speaking, they changed the law in, I think it was the 90s. Give me just one second. But basically, they did change the law. And even according, here we go. Yeah, actually, it was in 1995. It says, quote, this is Texas Transportation Code section 521.021 says, quote, a person other than a person expressly exempted under this chapter may not operate a motor vehicle on a highway in this state unless a person holds a driver's license issued under this chapter, close quote. So unfortunately, all of that case law, like in the 40s and 50s, in a lot of ways doesn't matter anymore. Because remember, those judges were adjudicating based on the statutes at that time. They were not ruling on constitutionality. So there's also that little difference. You see the problem there. So you could call it maybe a little bit of that constitutional avoidance doctrine that the federal government abides by. It could be argued here, maybe the Texas judiciary was doing something similar. And that, like I said a minute ago, you were being a little bit skeptical about the judiciary. Perhaps you're right. Because they really were only adjudicating based on the statute. And the VACS, not based on anything in, say, the Texas Bill of Rights, which, of course, is Article 1 of the Texas Constitution here.
Yeah.
So there is that. So maybe it was a legal interstice. Maybe it was a loophole. But, yeah, once 1995 happened, you're screwed. It's done. You have to have a driver's license. Sorry. As best as I can tell, as a layman, as a non-lawyer, doing the legal research, going back into, like, the 40s and such, that does seem to be the case where they just changed the law.
Huh. Okay, interesting. So is there anything else you want to say in regards to, you know, I mean, you kind of walked us through the history. Is there anything you want to speak to on, you know, driver's licensure?
No, I think we kind of need to get on to the others.
Okay, all right. So the next on the list is vehicle registration.
Okay, so this was my article, Extraconstitutional Number 2. Are Texans mandated to register their vehicles? I'll try to be a little bit briefer about this one. Suffice it to say, millions of people are still affected by this. The FHA, Federal Highway Administration statistics kind of show that this affects millions of people, even just right here in Texas, okay? So this is a widespread thing. Now this is interesting. Vehicle registration actually is tied to land ownership.
Huh.
That's very important. So I know statists like to talk about the federal government a lot, and they like to talk about roads and the interstate highway system in particular, but the federal constitution in Article 1, Section 8, Clause 7 only mentions about post offices and post roads being an enumerated power of the Congress and so forth. Not all roads, not, you know, major highways, not like it says, the Congress shall have power to establish post offices and post roads. That's, and remember, this is supposed to be a government of limited powers. Unfortunately, when you look at certain treatises by various jurists, I quoted Joseph Story. He then says, regarding the Postal Clause in Chapter 18 of his Commentaries on the Constitution, quote, the power to establish post offices and post roads has never been understood to be limited to the point, to the power to point out and designate post offices and post roads. And close quote. There's more to it, but just for purpose of time, I just want to limit myself. So,
he's saying, like, I don't know much about Joseph Story, but it's,
he's supposed to be a minarchist, actually.
Unlimited power.
Here's the weird contradiction. Joseph Story, as far as I can tell, is admired by the minarchists. So I don't know if it's naivete on their part. I don't know if they're just closeted authoritarians or what, but they like Joseph Story. But Joseph Story says here regarding the roads issue, regarding the federal government, and I'll get to Texas in a minute, regarding the federal government, that the power to establish post offices and post roads has never been understood to be limited to the point to power out to designate post offices and post roads. That's what he says.
Isn't that what it said in the Constitution?
The Congress shall have power to establish post offices and post roads. And right, so that's why when I made my comment about, well, I guess the hypothetically limited government is not restrained by judicial review in the 10th Amendment. All power is not expressly delegated to this government as reserved to the states or to the people. I'm paraphrasing a little bit. Okay, so I guess, well, geez, I mean, let's just throw out the whole notion of limited government at that point. We don't even need to get into, like, weird issues or extremes of, like, wars and stuff. Just regarding something as simple as a blasted road. It's not a limited
Yeah,
government.
and that's a huge statement for him to make, because I mean, the road, like I said at the beginning, in the introduction, this is something like the public roads and, you know, driver's licensure and things like that. This affects everybody. So if that's not, you know, limited by the Constitution according to this this minarchist, then that's pretty profound.
Unless I'm mistaken, and he's an outright authoritarian, and the Patriots are just being naive, which is possible. I want to give as much benefit of the doubt. Okay, I want to be fair here, but that's what Joseph Story said. I like to think I understand the English language. Okay, Constitution says limited government, 10th Amendment and all that, states' rights, blah, 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 you know, whatever. Let me say state sovereignty. Let me put it that way. State sovereignty and so forth. And Joseph Story is saying no federal government can do whatever the hell it wants with roads.
Wow.
Did I misunderstand something? Again, my email is kyle@thelastbastille.com for your hate mail or just questions or whatever. Anyway, for purposes of time, let me kind of skip around a little bit here. Basically, the long and short of it is that Joseph Story in chapter 26 of, again, Commentaries on the Constitution said the following. Now, this is very, very important. There's a longer quote, but I'll just say the shorter part of it. Quote, the right of soil may remain in the state, meaning the several states, in the state or in individuals, and the right to the easement only in the national government, close quote. So not only is he like really contradicting himself in a lot of ways, but it's kind of like, okay, do you pick the other quote or you pick, I mean, it's from the same piece of literature. It's just different chapters, yes. Unless I'm misunderstanding him somewhere.
Yeah, so is it the federal government or the state government, Mr. Story? I don't know. I'm confused.
I don't know, man. Me personally, just because of how I am, I'm just going to assume that what he said in that other one, because it serves my interests better. I'm going to be perfectly upfront about this. What he said in that other quote serves my interests better. So that's what I'm going to go with, because he's contradicting himself, okay? As far as I'm concerned, he's dialogically stopped. He's violating argumentation ethics. He's violating the private property ethic. So I don't know. I'll just pick something and run with it because, well, I don't know what else to do. So anyway, he's claiming right of soil may remain in the state or in individuals, and that with the federal government, it's an easement issue. So the question I'm kind of going with in terms of trying to answer the question about vehicle registration is that you kind of have to ask a preliminary question, who owns the roads, or more precisely, who owns the soil? That's the key thing, the land, the dirt underneath the roads. I then go into, I think, a couple pages where I basically try to make sense of some of like municipal city charters. I look at Houston. I even look right here in Austin, and they like say different things. And like, there's this weird shades of gray kind of nonsense where sometimes, like, supposedly Houston has something akin to like home rule, but like Austin doesn't. It's really weird. Like you remember like Rayo in his book Vanu, The Search for Personal Freedom. He would be mentioning things like free isles or free ports.
Uh-huh. Yeah, definitely.
Well, Houston, I don't know, unless I'm misunderstanding something, Houston is like a borderline free port. Like, it's almost like a sovereign city state almost. But for some reason, Austin isn't. It's still subject to the Texas government, but Houston is like not quite sovereign, and it's like a Greco-Roman city state almost, but it's on its way. It's like this weird in-between shades of gray crap where the Houston government actually owns the roads, not the Texas government or even the county government.
But that's interesting.
But,
yeah.
but like the Austin government doesn't own the roads. It just has like right of control or whatever the legal language is. So there's this weird shades of gray, legally slimy lawyer talk. And even I can't make sense of it. And I wish people would help me on this. And maybe in the future, that could be a future project if people want to make it more of a collaborative effort to try and figure out some things that unfortunately I couldn't get an answer to. But what I was able to do in this series was get a lot of answers. So let's keep going. Probably the favorite thing regarding vehicle registration specifically was the fact that everything really depended on definitions. Again, kind of like the driver licensure, right? So Texas Transportation Code section 502.040 paragraph A, subparagraph 1, says not more than 30 days after purchasing a vehicle or becoming a resident of this state, the owner of a motor vehicle, trailer, or semi-trailer shall apply for the registration of the vehicle for each registration year in which the vehicle is to be used or to be used on a public highway, and so forth. And that was, 2012, actually.
Wow, okay, that's pretty recent, huh?
Yeah, there's some kind of weird issues. I mean, maybe they were redoing some older... Hold on, let me check a quick second. I think they might have been rephrasing it. Okay, there was some stuff in the VACS going back to 1936, but again, it only applied to chauffeurs, actually. So
does that mean that before 2012, vehicle registration, you know, in Texas, you know, was not, you know,
it was for some people, yes, it was. If you're making
for the chauffeurs, yeah, but for like non-commercial personal use, it doesn't seem like it was, you know, required.
Hold on a sec, I'm just double checking some things. Hold on, there's the 1948 edition. Give me a second. Hold on. Every owner of a motor vehicle trailer or semi-trailer to be used upon the public highways of this state shall apply to the county tax collector for the registration. Okay, well, definitely since 1948.
Okay, fair enough. I was going to say, you know, they kind of were a little late to the party on that one.
But again, I can't emphasize enough, regardless of which infringement we're talking about, with some very few exceptions, generally speaking, this is a slow erosion of our rights. That's the point here. So even though I can very briefly kind of go over these things and maybe point out a few, you know, specific facts here and there, with all of the facts available in the actual extra-constitutional series for people who really want to get into the nitty-gritty and the deep stuff, but suffice it to say, this is a slow erosion of our rights in some way, shape, or form or another. I did spend a little bit of time on the definitions, though, because there actually is a case for road privatization here, but I think it might be a legal interstice, but it's based off these definitions. So I would like to take a minute or two and go over that.
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
So again, still in that chapter 502 of TTC. So again, it's only vehicles used on a public highway. Okay, if you have a vehicle using a public highway, it has to be registered. That's the law. So the question is, what is a vehicle? What is a public highway? So the definition, and again, in chapter 502, in this chapter, motor vehicle means a vehicle that is self-propelled. Oh, fuck. Really? So they use, so of this legal term called motor vehicle, they actually use one of the words. Think about the logical fallacy here. In order to define a two-word legal term, they actually use one of the words in that legal term to describe the thing they're trying to identify. You know, circular reasoning much?
Yeah.
Again, in this chapter, motor vehicle, legal term, motor vehicle means a what? Vehicle that is self-propelled. I can't make this up, people.
And you mentioned there it's actually the next right after that quote. Awfully convenient to define a term by one of its own words, isn't it? I guess that bicycles, skateboards, and scooters would also come within the definition of what constitutes a motor vehicle. Also, I have yet to see a self-propelled trailer.
Well, yes, that. At that point, I was just getting sarcastic, and maybe a little bit of Gary Hunt's writings are rubbing off on me in terms of his style, right? Because he does that too, especially when he gets frustrated whenever the federal government is getting obtuse or just nonsensical in their legal wranglings, right? I'm noticing something this with the Texas government, though, with their legalisms and so forth. So anyway, let's continue because I want to make the case for this real briefly. So now we have to, okay, motor vehicle means a vehicle that is self-propelled. Okay, well, now we have to go friggin' find out the definition for what a vehicle is. So in this chapter, vehicle means a device in or by which a person or property is or may be transported or drawn on a public highway, other than a device used exclusively on stationary rails or tracks. Okay, well, wait a minute. The original vehicle registration law said vehicle is used or to be used on a public highway, but then the definition for vehicle also mentioned public highway too. So it's both the actual requirement in the law that they'll enforce against you and so forth, but it's also in the definition for vehicle. So obviously, whatever the hell a public highway is, we need to find out. So you see the problem here. We're now three definitions in.
Oh, yeah, and we're not done yet, are we?
Well, we're almost going to be, because I think this might cinch it. And then this is kind of hopefully my argument, and maybe some smart lawyer might be able to defend somebody else if they can hear this as a possible defense. Who knows? I mean, I guess there's a little bit of hope, maybe, at least before we abolish government, which I'll also try to make a case for tonight as well. In this chapter, public highway includes a road, street, way, thoroughfare, or bridge. Well, boy, that's a lot of different things, huh? Or bridge, A, that is in this state, okay, so boundaries, B, that is for the use of vehicles, remember what was vehicle defined as, device that's on the public highway, ooh, little bit of circular reasoning still, okay, that is for the use of vehicles, C, this is the important one, that is not privately over which the state has legislative jurisdiction under its police power. Now, obviously, the D one is also pretty dangerous, Shane, because that would arguably include things like eminent domain.
Yeah.
So
yeah, but I think that most important was definitely C. That is not privately owned or controlled.
So I think you can kind of see where there might be a legal interstice, which is simply this. And again, just to be clear, I can't say this enough. I'm not a lawyer. I don't play one on TV. You know, take this for a grain of salt and do your own research. Go look at the right to travel bibliography and make up your own mind. But to me as a non-lawyer, it seems to be the case that if you are on a private road and your privately owned automobile does not leave that private road, especially if hypothetically, let's say it's a network of private roads and you never get off it or otherwise go onto a public highway from the private network of private roads, for example, then I would assume based on what the statutory law says that you are not obligated to register your vehicle because it's not a vehicle at that point. Remember the definition of vehicles, it has to be on the public highway. And if you're not on the public highway, it's not a vehicle, right? It would be, you know, it would be something else. I like saying it's an automobile, that's just me. Now, again, if I made a mistake in my reasoning, Kyle at thelastbastille.com for all of your lovely love mail, or would it be hate mail at this point? I don't know, it just depends how people feel about this kind of thing. But look, I mean, what I'm saying is like, I try to actually be serious in my research and try to figure this stuff out. It's kind of like a big puzzle, right? Like what actually happened here? So anyway, just for purposes of time, I want to kind of skip around a little bit. That's pretty much the most important stuff. So let's go ahead and get to the next one, next infringement.
Okay. This next one is emissions inspection. I want to provide one of my, you know, personal observations. I used to work at a finance company and, it wasn't in all 50 states, but we had California and something. And so what I did was I'd approve people for like, you know, financing and things and have to look at the sales tickets to make sure there's no discrepancies or anything. And one thing I noticed pretty consistently was that in California, people would like, you know, they take out 185% financing, you know, APR financing out on basic maintenance in California, and like all the taxes, the emissions inspections, all of that sort of stuff. So, just from like what California requires for your vehicle to be legal, people were financing, you know, like $200 bills on this and then ending up paying back like $500. Like it's truly, truly insane.
Yeah, I'm not, I can't say I'm completely surprised about that. And, you know, just as a historical issue and I just want to kind of bring this up before I get into the meat of the article, which is just simply this. A lot of the lobbying for emissions inspection laws and similar things was actually by the mainstream statist environmental lobby, which, of course, I know a lot of people don't like environmentalism, but it's like, well, I'm an environmentalist, me personally. I just want people to use markets to actually protect the air and the soil and you know, maybe even a couple birds or something, right? I don't want to live in a place where I can't breathe, okay? Let me put it that way. However, I think that the mainstream environmentalists who want to use government law and coercion to try and protect the physical environment, I think, are actually damaging the environment. Like, look at the EPA, right? The Environmental Protection Agency and such. Again, that's federal government. But you know, I actually do care about, you know, making sure that the water is, you know, drinkable and clean, potable, right? At the very least, right? And, you know, as an environmentalist myself, I'm completely against all this emissions inspection stuff because it actually doesn't protect the environment and it's highly bureaucratic and it penalizes people who are actually not the worst polluters. Remember, the worst polluters are actually the government. That's been scientifically proven. Now,
definitely. And I want to mention this too. Now, like California and New York, like obviously you'd expect like places like that, you know, the leftists that they are. I remember a South Park episode where it might have been Stan and his family moved out to California and they were sniffing their own farts to reduce the emissions of their flatulence. And I would expect that from like California, but like Texas actually has emissions inspections requirements, don't they? That's these right wing gun toting folks, you know, are, you know, there's and there's still this emissions inspection requirement.
Well, yeah, but consider also the voter bases in the big cities, right? I mean, Texas, I probably arguably has the highest concentration of major city areas, right? You have Dallas, DFW, you've got, I think El Paso would probably count, which might as well be Mexico. You have San Antonio, obviously you have the I-35 corridor, which would include actually San Antonio and where I'm at in Austin. And obviously there's the Houston area. I guess Corpus Christi probably might as well. Maybe arguably comes some other areas. I know some people mention Amarillo occasionally. But yeah, I would say it's mainly pretty much the city rats that in a lot of ways that would arguably be pushing. Because I'm sorry, I just don't see a lot of people in rural areas basically pushing for this kind of stuff and lobbying well, I can't say Congress critter now, can I? Their state legislating thingy to go to the, you know, the tea sippers right up here at the Capitol in downtown and pass, you know, get us, well, one more law closer to their utopia, you know, their fascist commie paradise, basically. But anyway, let's get to the meat of this article. This is extra constitutional number 3. Are Texans compelled to be inspected for emissions? Now, I did mention, as I was saying earlier, you know, I've been personally affected by these right to travel infringements. Well, here's one thing that happened to me. So let's see, my last traffic stop was involving a ticket where I was accused, and I still maintain my innocence because I think it's an unjust law. So not necessarily going for a jury nullification defense. I just think it's an unjust law, period. It was on the grounds of no valid inspection certificate, brackets, failure to display expired inspection certificate. Ooh, my gosh, I must be a criminal. But again, that's papers.
Bad man.
Yeah. Oh, owl master, please stop hitting with your newspaper, right? Yeah, it's pretty much paperwork crimes, right? Papers, may I see your papers, please? It's exactly what the hell it is. So basically, long story short, as far as that goes, there was a legal interstice that I ended up using, which actually minimized my costs. And even though I did have to go down to the courthouse, I never actually saw the justice of the peace. I didn't actually get into the courtroom. I don't know if people really understand this. Maybe some of you do who have had to experience issues with traffic tickets. Yep. I never actually saw, justice of the peace. I guess that's the same as a judge or a magistrate, or maybe there's shades of gray between them. But I never actually saw, let's say, the Black Road individual. I never saw one. I only dealt with a bureaucrat through like some sort of bulletproof glass or something. Like it was some sort of,
Oh, really? That's interesting. Like when I mentioned my expired registration proof of insurance. Well, when I had a court date, I went in and it was the prosecutor actually.
Yeah. So I think that's something is what you said before in your articles.
Yeah. Right? And the prosecutor is like, okay, proof of insurance. Good. And I said, yeah, I just forgot. I forgot to, you know, update my registration. I did it the day after I got pulled over. Here's the proof. Okay. Chit. Okay. You're good to go. So yeah, I never saw a judge either. If they had a judge for traffic court, that'd be like government. Like government is obviously wasteful, but that would just be overly wasteful because you know how many people are in there like on a daily basis for those bullshit paper violations. It's unreal.
It's like it's like almost as bad as an assembly line, right? So in any case, I basically was able to kind of resolve that, but I still wanted to know, and even for the longest time afterward, I wanted to know what exactly had happened to me. And even during that particular traffic stop, you know, I even asked the officer, like I said in the article, like, what if I didn't sign the ticket? And he said very clearly to me what he would be willing to do. And as we go on the further articles, I actually got even deeper into the reasonings behind it. And I'll cover it then. But suffice it to say, this was when that first came up, was this traffic stop regarding the emissions inspections. I actually found out some weird due process issues that maybe even the police officer himself didn't even know the statutory issues behind it regarding arrests, actually, because technically I was arrested, even though he'd never put handcuffs on me. I'll get to that in a bit, but let's stick to the emissions inspection for a moment. So basically, the long and short of it is basically this. They changed the law. The way in which they enforce the emissions inspections is now different. The current law is dramatically different than what I was getting harassed over. And hold on, I'm trying to find the term that was used. Hold on 1 second. Okay, so the old law was called, you'll love this in terms of the bureaucratic legalese, the inspection sticker-based enforcement. So remember, there's two stickers you have to have on the, and if you're in the driver's seat, this would be the lower left-hand corner. Lower left-hand corner, I believe, of the, you have to have the vehicle registration sticker. So there's that, just like we've already covered. And then there's also the old law was you also have to have a separate sticker right next to the vehicle registration one, which is the inspection sticker. That was the old law, and that's what I was getting harassed over. the new and current law is something called the registration-based enforcement. So old law, inspection, sticker-based enforcement, new or current law, registration-based enforcement. And you'll love what they did, Shane. I'll just explain it vernacularly because there's actually a lot of legalese here, and I don't want to say this, you know, verbally, because it would just take too much time and be rather confusing for people. Here's the simple version. What they did was they changed the law to where they tied emissions inspections to the hip of vehicle registration, as I've already discussed. So what that means is, remember what I said about vehicle registration. If you're not taking your automobile on the public highways, the best I can figure it is that you're not obligated to register your vehicle. However, if you do take your automobile onto the public highways, then yes, you must get that vehicle registered. Okay, it's
and I'm getting and you'll probably get into this, but I'll just kind of posit a guess here that if you before you can get your vehicle registered, I'm sure you have to have an emissions inspection first. Is that the case?
I'm trying to remember right offhand. I know it's in my article, so maybe I'll just
because I know here in Illinois you have to take in proof of insurance before you can register your vehicle. So maybe it's similar in that way.
I remember too when I had to get the last emissions inspection, I had to show proof of insurance too. And again, we'll get to that also too, the insurance issue, because actually there was a misunderstanding on my part that I discovered as I was writing that article, which actually is, it's actually, there are other options, not auto insurance, that actually satisfy what they call evidence of financial responsibility. But let's stick to emissions inspection for a moment. Yep, okay, let's finish that. So they changed the law. So basically, let me put it this way. I would not be subjected to a traffic stop for the reason of the officer happened to look at my windshield and he thinks I might have done the paperwork, you know, victimless crime of not getting the latest sticker or whatever the hell. That actually would not happen now because they changed the law. The police were informed. There was like a big press. In fact, actually, the Texas government, they called it the Two Steps, One Sticker campaign, which was this educational campaign to inform law enforcement not to harass people for not having vehicle inspection stickers simply because the law had changed. So police, cops don't, you know. It was actually a big deal here a couple years ago when the law changed because people were affected by it, myself included. And so, but the question is like, is it any better? And it's like, let me put it this way, everybody. There is a requirement. Hold on. Let me see if I can pull up the exact reference. There is a requirement where you do have to show, actually, let's delay on that. I mentioned it in a later article, but I'll just mention this in passing. I'll get the citation in a bit. You have to have something now called a vehicle inspection report. It's a one-page piece of paper you get from whomever, whatever garage business that you went to, mechanic shop, who've actually performed the emissions inspections. And you have to, and if you're at a, and if you're subjected to a traffic stop, and if the officer asks you during the traffic stop for the vehicle inspection report, you better produce it on the spot, because if you don't, that's grounds for a ticket.
Okay.
So now you go from a situation of the sticker thing where the sticker is either current or it's not, and he can just look on the windshield, it's right next to the vehicle registration one, and it's like, boom, and then you have to go from there to now where there is no sticker. The assumption is that if your vehicle registration is up to date, your emissions inspection would also be up to date, presumably, at least before the cop even starts talking to you, right? Because he can just look at your vehicle registration sticker. Mm-hmm. But if he goes one more step in the interrogation and he asks, hey there, son, I would like you to produce your vehicle inspection report or something to that effect, you better damn well do it. And I'll get to that in a later article why that was. And see, as you can see, as I was writing the series, I was actually discovering things that I had already covered in earlier articles, but I didn't know like the full issue. So I was kind of trying to update it as best as I could, kind of like some of Gary's articles in his series, right?
Yeah.
And so forth. Like he takes snapshots of that are happening because he's an investigative journalist. I was doing just more research here, but I was discovering new things too. So I'll get to that in a bit. I think it was an extra constitutional number 7, actually. But anyway, regarding this, they changed the law. And so the takeaway from the emissions inspection is simply this. People are worried about the federal government. What was rather fascinating here with the emissions inspections here in Texas, Shane, is that the federal government used to be more heavily involved in the right to travel infringement, specifically the emissions inspections right here in Texas, vis-a-vis, and you'll love this, the Environmental Protection Agency, and there was even a reference to the Code of Federal Regulations.
Wow.
That's and because you had me on before, I think it was like last year or the year before or something, the episode that was done on administrative agencies.
Yep.
That's all fourth branch of government bullcrap. Now, that's what it used to be. The current law is federal government is not involved, from as best as I can tell. But how do I say this? The situation has now changed to where the Texas administrative agencies, like the, I'm trying to pull up their name right offhand. Oh, here we go. Like the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality.
Wow.
So you see the problem.
That's a name.
So you see the problem here. You went from a situation of a federal administrative agency being involved in emissions inspections here in Texas, at least to some degree, to now the current law, where the feds, I don't think they're involved, at least not from the TTC. They're not involved, at least to that extent, but these other, including the commission, these Texas administrative agencies are involved. So you can kind of see there was a changing of the guard. But other than that, and how the emissions inspections are enforced, where now you have to produce one more piece of paper called a vehicle inspection report, other than that, can anybody honestly say anything as foundationally changed?
But Kyle, aren't you happy that the federal government's not now involved and now you're just getting oppressed by the state government? That's good, right? That's states' rights?
See, and that's why I don't support the 10th Amendment Center and their so-called state nullification crap, because it, in large part, it doesn't even apply to this. So yeah, you're right in saying that, yeah, the federal government apparently is not in play anymore, at least regarding this specific infringement. But now it's the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality, as well as also DPS, Department of Public Safety. Those are the state police with the cowboy hats, with the tan shirts and the tan pants and such. My last traffic stop too, by the way, was those guys. Uh-huh.
Interesting.
That's exactly what the hell it is. Now, just for purpose of time, let's get on the next one.
Okay. All right. Liability certification, or in parentheses, auto insurance. Now, obviously, I know here in Illinois, you've got to have at least liability. And I'll mention his name, but this was a couple of years back when I used to listen to him. But I'm pretty sure I heard Christopher Campbell mention that New Hampshire doesn't have a requirement on have a law requiring you to have like auto insurance, and apparently the cost is cheaper. According to his own personal observations. And if it's 20, 30 bucks a month, I mean, if you have a nice vehicle, I mean, yeah, it's kind of worth, having, or if you don't have a nice vehicle and to kind of save your ass for liability purposes. But, let's talk a little about that.
Okay. So this was extraconstitutional number 4. Are Texans obliged to insure their automobiles? Now, the first part of this article I'm going to skip over because I provide more of like an economic view of kind of looking at this. And who knows, maybe the Austrians would agree with me on this. Maybe they won't. Who knows? Maybe even the public choice, the Virginia School of Economics, maybe they'll agree with this or not. I don't know. Again, my email is kyle@thelastbestdeal.com for all of your hate mail. I kind of have an issue with limited liability. Okay, let me put it that way. I view it as a form of socialism. So I go into more details. Purpose of time, I'm going to skip over that. Let's just get to the law. So TTC section 601.051 basically says that you must produce evidence of financial responsibility. Now, there are multiple ways to do this. And see, this was actually a real surprise to me. I actually didn't honestly know this, and I learned this as I was writing and the article and such. Apparently, in Texas, there are other options, not auto insurance, that are that can legally satisfy the evidence of financial responsibility requirement. Now, people are familiar with auto insurance, at least to some degree, and I don't think it's worth really spending much time on that. So let's get to the alternatives, okay?
For sure. Let's do it.
People can follow along in the article for the precise citations. And again, I want to be respectful of everybody's time because I could literally go on for hours and hours. Because this is an entire series of articles, maybe even a small book at some point, an audiobook maybe, I don't know. But let's look at the surety bonds. And for people who want to follow along, this is chapter 601 in the TTC. So surety bonds, it says, quote, "The bond is a lien in favor of the state on the real property described in the bond. The lien exists in favor of a person who holds a final judgment against the person who filed the bond," close quote. So essentially what's going on here is that one option of satisfying the evidence of financial responsibility requirement, not auto insurance, is through surety bonds. And basically the surety bonds are a way of collateralizing assets that you own so that they can be used to pay a judgment if the bondholder, in this case presumably you, is adjudicated to be at fault for a car accident. I'm going to say that again because this is important to understand. The surety bonds are a way of collateralizing assets so they can be used to pay a judgment if the bondholder is adjudicated to be at fault for a car accident. So for example, if you own a couple of businesses, like let's say a small local chain of, let's say, three or four laundromats and a restaurant, okay? And let's assume that, and there is a lot of legalese I didn't get into in the article, but let's assume that it fulfills all the other bureaucratic requirements that you could put up maybe, let's say, two of your three laundromats that are financially worth enough to satisfy the equivalent of the auto insurance requirements for like limited liability and such. But instead of doing limited liability, you're on strict liability here, which I know the ANCAPs and voluntarists like, but the way that that's enforced with the current government, Texas law in the TTC is that you would basically be putting, you would be voluntarily, see, voluntary should like this, right? Or arguably, maybe. It is government law after all. You do.
Well, I don't know about that though, because it's an alternative to, it is a requirement. You either have to get this or you have to
and
get
that. And that is coercive. But in terms of like the different options, you could choose one of the, if you did own like a couple of businesses, let's say hypothetically, actually some people realistically can do this today, obviously, put up, let's say, two of those three laundromats and voluntarily, at least in some sense, choose to put a lien or put a bond or get surety bonds and put those liens up against their laundromats and such, so that later if they're driving around and they T-bone somebody, depending on the nature of the how the strict liability is going to be carried out, which is what ANCAP's like, then yeah, you might lose one or both of the laundromats, depending on like medical bills and car repair bills and such. But hey, you didn't need insurance and you would be obeying the law. So it's a legal interstice is what I'm saying. It's one option for people who already own assets that can be collateralized.
Huh, interesting.
Now let's get to another one. And let's see. So this would be there's the $55,000 deposit one. There's actually two different versions of this. So I'll briefly go over both. One version is where you basically deposit $55,000 with the Texas State Comptroller. Think of him as like the chief accountant. Let me put it this way. The guy who produces the comprehensive annual financial reports, the CAFRs for the state of Texas, yeah, that's the bureaucrat. So if you deposit $55,000 with that particular bureaucrat, there's also some other regulations, I don't want to spend time on that here, but there's some other things. But generally speaking, again, as a non-lawyer, if you deposit $55,000 with the state comptrollers and a couple of their red tape, then you will receive a certificate of deposit. That certificate of deposit you need to keep with you, because again, as I'll get to when, as I'm going through my own articles, I'll get the references. Again, at a traffic stop, just like with the vehicle inspection report, with the emissions inspections, if the officer is like, "Okay, I want to see proof of your," he'll probably say proof of insurance, but technically the actual legal wording is evidence of financial responsibility. If you produce that certificate of deposit, and as long as you followed the statutory, rules and regulations or whatever the hell, then he has to accept that and he can't ticket you for driving without insurance. See how that works?
Yeah.
That's definitely what the law says. Now, the other variation on the $55,000 is instead of depositing it with the Texas State Comptroller, you would deposit it with, and I think you might like this in this almost in a roundabout way, but you would actually deposit it instead with a particular county judge within the county wherein the vehicle is registered. I'm going to say that again. The other $55,000 version is that you deposit $55,000 with the county judge within the county wherein the vehicle is registered. Now, what makes this interesting, and there's a couple other regulations where also like the county sheriff has to be notified too of the deposit or some other things too. Actually, hold on, I can read this exactly. This is from TTC section 601.123 paragraph C. Quote, on receipt of the deposit, the county judge shall issue to the person making the deposit a certificate stating that a deposit complying with this section has been made. The certificate must be acknowledged by the sheriff of that county and filed with the department, close quote. And that was back in 1995, okay? That was when it was passed. So that's rather interesting. That's a third. I've now shown you three alternatives to having insurance that actually is consistent with state law, at least in the TTC at bare minimum.
Very good. Yeah, you know, it's always good to have options.
Yeah, so if you happen to have assets that you can that you're willing to collateralize and willing to put up in risk in that sense, or you've got $55,000 of spare change hiding underneath your sofa cushions, and you don't like the auto insurance companies, maybe you want to take a look at some of these legal interstices and see if it floats your boat, especially if you're one of those, you know, constitutionalists who are big on state sovereignty, because none of this involves the federal government. Okay, I'm talking about state comptroller, a county judge within the county wherein the vehicle is registered, and then, of course, just, you know, the surety bonds in general. There was also another option that was mentioned. I'll mention it just for a few seconds here. There was a fourth option I did mention in the article, but I don't think it's very realistic because it really only applies to people who own quite literally, I think it was like well in excess of like 20 different vehicles. So there was kind of an assumption being made that like you're running like a transportation company of some kind. And it was something called like self,
or maybe a dealership,
and some of the other legalistic wording, which I don't want to repeat here, was kind of implying, as best as I can understand, again, as a non-lawyer, that they call it self-insurance, but that's kind of a bad way of putting it, because again, they said, I think they may have even said fleet or group of vehicles. And it was like more than 12 or more than 20 or more than 30. It was like a lot of like more vehicles, quote unquote, than I think your average, you know, mom, dad, kids in a suburb would be owning, even if they did have like 2.5 children with a white picket fence, right? I don't think they're
would it kind of be like they own all these vehicles, they probably have enough money, we'll just kind of, you know, exempt them from this kind of,
well, provide them an alternative, right? They still have to have the proof of the so-called self-insurance, but the term is misleading because it's like, okay, but it's not like normal people who don't have well in excessive, so unless you're like a multi-millionaire, multi-billionaire, or you're somebody who's running a transportation company or something along those lines, arguably, I don't see how this could be applicable to you and me. And at that point, the other options like the surety bonds and the two different versions of the $55,000 deposit are automatically much more realistic rather than having, you know, this entire fleet of you know, cars you're probably not going to drive.
Definitely. Yeah.
And I'm simply just saying, this is what the law says. This is what I've discovered. Let's see, I'm going to skip around a bit. I want to see if there's anything else I want to mention here. Okay, one thing I do want to mention here before we get on to the next infringement is something that does involve the insurance, but it also involves some of the other infringement that I was mentioning. I do want to read this verbatim. It's not very long, but I think it's significant. This was the 2004 Danny Murphy versus State of Texas case, and this was in the Court of Appeals for the First District of Texas. So this was appellate court, you know, this was in the appellate judiciary. And this is the ruling. It's not very long. Quote, appellant Danny Royce Murphy was convicted in the city of Kama Municipal Court of four misdemeanors, operating an unregistered vehicle. Okay, get that one. Driving a motor vehicle without a valid driver's license. Okay, see that? Operating a motor vehicle without displaying a valid certificate of inspection. See how this kind of piles up one after the other? And operating a motor vehicle without evidence of financial responsibility. Okay, those are the four. Got it? Now, appellant appealed to county court and received a trial de novo because the city of Cameo Municipal Court is not a court of record. The county court also found appellant guilty of all four charges. The court assessed punishment at a fine of $50 in each case. So he was looking at $200. Appellant filed timely notions of appeal. We have no jurisdiction over the appeals. And see, that's why they ruled against him, because they didn't have jurisdiction. Now, listen to this. This is important. Especially, the sole issue is the constitutionality of the statute or ordinance on which the conviction is based. We are without jurisdiction when the fine imposed in the lower court does not exceed $100. Remember, it was 50 each case, each charge, if you will. Each of appellant's fines was less than $100. That's true. We therefore examine the brief appellant filed in this court. This is the important part. He raised no challenge to the constitutionality of a statute or ordinance. Everybody get that? We therefore have no jurisdiction over the appeals. The appeals are dismissed for lack of jurisdiction, close quote. That was the entirety of the ruling in the Danny Murphy case. You see where he screwed up.
Yeah.
So there are two elements there. One was the fine was too low. They weren't punishing him harshly enough, if you will. But the more important issue was he still could have made a go at it if he had challenged the constitutionality of all of this horrible shit I've just been spending the last little bit briefly going over. He didn't challenge constitutionality. And this was 2004, okay? Keep in mind, this was right after Iraq got invaded.
Yeah.
So just to give, you know, a sense of time here. So I'm going to skip over a couple other things. There's a lot of court cases that deal in the extra constitutional number four about insurance. Here's the long and short of it. The insurance policies are written contracts. And so contract law is what's really kind of involved there, whether and especially in an auto insurance company, but not necessarily limited to automobiles, whether they have to pay out anything to people who make claims on their policies and so forth. So that being said, unless there's something else you want to mention, we should kind of get a move on with the next one.
Okay, and we're almost there, guys. We got a couple more traffic stops and general funding, but traffic stops. Let's go ahead and go forward with that one.
Okay, this is extra constitutional number five. Are Texans extorted at the side of the road? Now,
yes.
Well, obviously, I know you'd say that, right? I mean, that's kind of what happened to you, right? And actually, it happened to me too. So I think it was the traffic stop before the last one. So my last traffic stop was the one involving the emissions inspections that I've already mentioned. Well, the one before that, and now we're getting back into my college years, people, just to tell you a little bit about my age. I've been around the block. Little joke there.
You still aren't our distinguished older gentleman, though. That's Jason.
That's true. That's true. I'm not quite a Gen Xer, still a millennial, technically. But in any case, this time I was accused of speeding 16 to 24 miles per hour over posted limit. And this time it was a municipal government. So that was interesting. So basically, just like the other one, I trundle on down to the municipal court. And basically, this one they did rake me over more so than the other one. There was a legal interstice I used, but I did have to pay $108, and I couldn't get that back. I did lose out on that. They did waive an additional $200, which, should I be thankful to the highwayman that he didn't steal as much from me?
You should get down on your knees. Yeah.
I also had to send a certified copy of my DPS driving record. There was also some other paperwork that I had to pay for out of my own pocket to get to them so I could even use the legal interstice. There was some other stuff going on, but that's why I only mentioned the 108, because that's what I actually lost out on. It's just like, I also mentioned the article again briefly, like what you said earlier, stuff that happened to you. I mentioned even some stuff that happened to Gary Hunt back in 1992. He was in trouble for driving without a license and not having tags or license plates on his motorcycle. And he got a null prosc. That's a no, do not prosecute, because he was trying to basically do an oral habeas corpus. And at one point, he actually asked the judge if the judge was suspending habeas corpus. And then basically in way less than 2 minutes, he was a free man. Charges dropped, out of there. No prosk. Yeah. I'm not saying whether that would work again. I'm just saying that that's what happened to him back in 1992. Okay. So sometimes people can arguably win. But yeah, apparently the oral habeas corpus, and the funny thing was the judge kept interrupting him too. And then at one point, Gary's like, you know, Mr. Marblestone, are you suspending habeas corpus? And that's when everything was like, boom, done, get him out. Drop the case. I'm out. Don't even want to address it. I was like, that's a crazy story.
Yeah, for sure.
And there were some other stories too, and I'll leave that to people who want to read extraconstitutional number 5. So let's get to the question: What did the CCA, Texas Court of Criminal Appeals, the other Texas Supreme Court? Because remember, there's two of them here in Texas: one for criminal, one for civil. What did the Texas CCA rule here about the legal standard for police officers to forcibly hold citizens? So here's the in summary. Between 1970 and 1986, the court has adjudicated that reasonable suspicion is dissimilar from probable cause, the latter of which is the higher legal standard for the issuance of both arrest and search warrants. Now, I'm going to read from the Texas Constitution because this is important. Because remember, traffic stops are the nexus for all of these other infringements. The other infringements really only matter in a lot of ways because of traffic stops. So this is kind of the linchpin. This is what actually makes it really dangerous and actually puts people's lives at risk. No joke. Okay. This is deadly serious, you know, adult grown-up type stuff. All right. Article 1, sections 9 and 29 out of the Texas Constitution say respectively that, quote, the people shall be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and possessions from all unreasonable seizures or searches, and no warrant to search any place or to seize any person or thing shall issue without describing them as near as may be, nor without probable cause supported by oath or affirmation. To guard against transgressions of the high powers herein delegated, we declare that everything in this Bill of Rights is exempt or accepted out of the general powers of government and shall forever remain inviolate. And all laws, not some, not a few, no, whatever, all laws contrary thereto or to the following provisions shall be void, end quote. That is what the hell the law says. That's constitutional law right here in Texas. Now, the question is, does the government actually obey it? And this is something I think arguably the most statist of the patriots would probably even agree with me about, which is simply this. So between 1970 and 1986, what the court did, and I think I will only read maybe just one of the court cases, mainly because it was just so repetitive over and over and through the article. There's a reason this article is like in the PDF format is like 8 pages, because I just excerpted just one paragraph from like each of these cases where the judges are saying the same thing over and over again, sometimes almost verbatim, because they're quote, because the newer cases were referencing the older case law, which is how I was able to trace it back all the as far as I did.
Okay.
So here's basically the idea. The Constitution says probable cause. That is the standard, and that's the standard for the warrants. Okay, that's the law. What happened, what the judiciary did, and Shane, remember what you said when we were covering driver licensure, and I was trying to be somewhat nice to the judiciary, and then you were saying, you know, maybe there's something else going on here?
Yeah, well, yeah, no commendation. Maybe they're just doing no commendation is necessary. They're just doing their job.
And now here, regarding the traffic stops, you are thoroughly vindicated, in a sense, because what – now, the court, the judiciary are actually the bad guys here. They actually did something extra constitutional. They actually did something really, really bad here. What they did was that they instituted through case law, what some people would call common law, through case law, they completely jimmied up this brand new legal standard, not in the Constitution, called reasonable suspicion. And it's a lower standard of proof, which doesn't require warrants. You see the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So they just invented, that's the part, name of the series, extra constitutionally created this brand new lower proof lower burden of proof legal standard underneath probable cause called reasonable suspicion. And basically in the case law, and people really need to read this stuff, because the original case that kind of got the ball rolling was in 1970 called Baby versus State, and it had nothing to do with automobiles whatsoever. Not traffic stops. They were talking about the context was stopping people on, like, pedestrians on a sidewalk. That was the original context. And then it morphed over time to these traffic stops.
Hmm.
So actually, on second thought, actually, I don't want to read these paragraphs verbatim just because they get really, really long. Or maybe I'll do it later. I don't know. But the point is, the probable cause, that's in the Constitution, requires warrants, and the judiciary extra-constitutionally decided we're going to have a lower burden of proof, we're going to call it reasonable suspicion, and basically the net result, the end game, was that police officers now have greater discretion, they have greater police power, shall I say, to do a lot more and get away with it. And it's technically not color of law in one sense, although arguably it is. I don't know. That's for lawyers to adjudicate. Again, I'm a non-lawyer. I'm just a normal man trying to figure out this shit.
So let me ask this then. I mean, there are some advocates of common law. I know there's quite a few in the sovereign citizen movement, and there's also some in obviously the Patriot movement. I mean, this is done via common law. Should they be for that?
That's a very good question. Maybe someone can actually answer that better than I can in the future if someone wants to take that question up. I honestly don't know how to answer that. There's some deeper questions there, aren't there? That might be a little uncomfortable, if you know what I mean. So that's rather interesting, because the judiciary were actually the bad guys here. Now, there is something else I do want to mention before we get on to the next infringement. Remember when we were talking just a bit ago about the emissions inspections and that I was technically under arrest? But they didn't slap the cuffs on? Okay, when I was writing this one on the traffic stops, I actually did get a firm answer. Let's go over that. So, drivers are actually under arrest when during that kind of portion of the traffic stop, more or less from the time the officer issues the ticket to roughly basically when it's signed. So let's go through some of this. And I want to read at least some of this verbatim, because it's freaky. It's in chapter 543 of the TTC, and people can look at the article and get the specific citations, but I just want to read some of this. Okay. Quote, a peace officer may arrest without warrant a person found committing a violation of this subtitle. Well, so much for probable cause. Anyway, a person arrested for a violation of this subtitle, punishable as a misdemeanor, shall be immediately taken before a magistrate if the person demands an immediate appearance before a magistrate or refuses to make a written promise to appear in court as provided by the subchapter. Remember what I said earlier about if I didn't sign the ticket?
Yep, that would be
refusing to make a written promise to appear. That's the legal language. Let me continue. An officer who arrests a person for a violation of this subtitle, punishable as a misdemeanor, and who does not take the person before a magistrate, shall issue a written notice to appear in court, that's the traffic ticket, by the way, showing the time and place the person is to appear, the offense charged, the name and address of the person charged, which is why they asked that, by the way. The officer's following the law. He is. Let me continue. Sorry. The name and address of the person charged, and if applicable, the license number of the person's vehicle. Oh, but it doesn't stop there. Let's go on the next one. To secure release. Wait, what? To secure release. This is TTC section, I think it's 543.005, I think is this one. To secure release. I didn't even know I was arrested. Well, yeah, you were. To secure release. The person arrested. I can't make this shit up. I'm going to say that again. To secure release. The person arrested must make a written promise to appear in court by signing the written notice, that's the traffic ticket, prepared by the arresting officer. Did I miss something?
One question that I'm sure some people, especially like on job application, have you ever been arrested? Anyone that's been pulled over in a traffic stop in Texas has been arrested.
Let me be a little bit more precise. The officers issued you the traffic ticket, but you haven't signed it yet. Maybe. And to be fair, maybe that is a debatable point. Again, I'm a non-lawyer. Just to say one more time, I'm trying to just figure this stuff out. Remember the legal maxim, ignorantia juris non excusat? This is me as a normal man trying to not be ignorant of the law, and I can't make sense of this crap. I'd like to think I'm not mentally retarded. Last time I checked, I graduated with you know, a Bachelor of Arts from, you know, a four-year university, okay? I'd like to think I'm at least of average intelligence. I can't make sense of this shit. Let me read this verbatim so people understand just how bad this is. To secure release, the person arrested must make a written promise to appear in court by signing the written notice prepared by the arresting officer. The signature may be obtained on a duplicate form or an electronic device capable of creating a copy of the signed notice. Yeah, that's just procedural stuff. The arresting officer shall retain the paper or electronic original of the notice and deliver the copy of the notice to the person arrested. This is the key part. The officer shall then promptly release the person from custody. You were arrested. I'm sorry. Same with me. Same with anybody that more or less falls under this. Yeah. Even though the cuffs weren't put on. That's loony, as far as I'm concerned. People getting arrested and they don't even put the cuffs on? Because at least when you have the cuffs on, it's kind of obvious, right? You know you're under arrest.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, this last one. Yeah, the last one in that section. Yeah, that's pretty bad.
A person who willfully violates a written promise to appear in court given as provided by the subchapter commits a misdemeanor regardless of the disposition of the charge on which the person was arrested. Okay, let's go back to my emissions inspection traffic stop. Let's say I hypothetically, just for all the lawyer types who may want to get me in trouble later because you're a bunch of douchebags, let's just say hypothetically I had chosen to do a different thing. Let's hypothetically say I did that last thing. I could have been charged with a misdemeanor because of at that time, as I have already explained, the law at that time said the cop was accusing me of the sticker thing or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I could have had a criminal record over this.
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
granted, it wouldn't have been a felony, thankfully, because remember, there's the whole issue with the federal government about felon in possession of firearm, and there's also a Texas version of that, but it conflicts with the federal version because there's a five year you know, grace period where after that you can have a gun again. But that's not quite true because Kevin Massey, whom I interviewed, is now a political prisoner, and he's a fellow Texan. So make sense of that one. But thankfully, that wouldn't apply to me necessarily because it's not a felony here. So that additional other stuff, which is other things like firearms or other things, or even trying to get a job or a loan or rent an apartment or a lot of things that people typically do as part of commercial activity or just other things. Yeah, you know, good luck trying to get on a plane, right?
Yep.
But I could have had a criminal record over this if I had made different choices. And not just me, but anybody in similar circumstances. You see how bad this is. Let me try to make an analogy very quickly here before we keep going. It's almost like with the government, they put their foot in the door. And that foot in the door would be something like the driver licensure or the vehicle registration or the emissions inspections or something related to the liability certification more broadly, not just the auto insurance. They put their foot in the door, and then if you happen to run afoul, and regardless of whether you actually truly did or not, but they think, they accuse you of running afoul of it, now they've got their foot in the door, now they can just open the door completely and metaphorically ruin your house, meaning your life, basically. I hope that makes sense to people. This is the shit that they've done, and the federal government isn't even involved.
The land of the free.
So all of you people who promote, you know, Tom Woods and his state nullification shit, that I've already criticized you people over, this, you want the state government to protect you against the feds, but the so-called state government is doing this shit, at least in Texas? My God in heaven, you people, you better get your head screwed on straight.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
So
definitely.
I didn't mean to get all excitable there, but this is crap. This is wrong. And that, again, as the name of the series, it's extra constitutional, which we'll get into in a bit as to why I chose that term. Regarding the rest of this, I think that's the important stuff, so let's get on to the next one.
Okay, so the final infringement on the right to travel is, you know, the general funding. Well, how are these, you know, these roads paid for? So let's go over that.
Okay, now we're going to talk about constitutionality. This one is extra constitutional number 6, who pays to build the roads? Because remember when we were going over vehicle registration, that was regarding, like, owning the roads or the soil underneath the roads and all of that. So in a kind of parallel kind of question to that, Who's actually paying? Who's footing the bill? Because I know a lot of people ask that type of question regarding a lot of things. So let's get into that. Well, as with all these things, let's look at the Constitution, the one for Texas, obviously. I don't want to read this verbatim, but here's the short version. There's different provisions in different articles of the Texas Constitution which simply say this. Certain types of taxes are constitutional. Ooh! Yeah, so for the listeners to remember the first part of this, remember when we're mentioning, especially in the overview and introduction, about the direct taxation versus the indirect taxation? Mm-hmm. Now this is where it becomes important. So apparently there are two different funds, and both of these are, I think, unfortunately, both of these are constitutional. One is called the State Highway Fund. The other one is called the Texas Mobility Fund. And these are the constitutionally enumerated, I guess you could call them just road funds that are run by the government. They are more or less administered by the, I believe it is TxDOT, I think that's accurate. That's the Texas Department of Transportation, and usually referred to by TxDOT, which is kind of like a kind of almost a bastardized way of trying to pronounce an acronym, which is actually TxDOT, but we usually call it TxDOT. That's what people commonly hear call it. It's an administrative agency. And that's not my opinion. That's according to the Texas State Library and Archives Commission, a completely different entity of element of the Texas government, calling TxDOT administrative agency. So now we're into fourth branch bullshit.
So let me ask this then. So there's the State Highway Fund and the Texas Mobility Fund. Why the hell do they need two different funds?
The reason for the State Highway Fund was obviously to carry out the taxing powers that were enumerated in the Texas Constitution to provide for the public roads. So that's kind of obvious. That makes more sense. Your question, though, is why is there two? Well, you see, the Texas Mobility Fund was actually amended into the Constitution later. And the reason that the bureaucrats, or I don't know if it was just, maybe it was the legislators too, the reason why the various public servants, government agents, the reason they basically advocated for it and got it passed and got it amended, they claimed they needed a, quote, revolving fund. And the State Highway Fund just wasn't good enough, so they needed another one to have a revolving fund that, I don't know, man. I mean, my personal impression as a non-lawyer, I think they want to do some embezzlement, quite frankly, but they wanted to legalize it. And again, if people want to double check on that and try to figure it out, again, my email, kyle@thelastbestial.com. But also, don't just email me with your hate mail. I would also suggest that you look at the Comprehensive Annual Financial Reports, or CAFRs, some of which I do link to and do provide, at least in part. But there's also the full versions you can get straight from the Texas State Comptroller. Yes, the same bureaucrat I mentioned in the other article, which is one of the options for the $55,000 deposit. Same entity and all that. So it's interesting. So if you actually look at the CAFRs, which are the real, I guess you could call them the real budgets. So there's the budgets, which are basically the estimates of where the different public servants say, well, we think we're going to spend X amount on Y activity over the next fiscal year, but we may or may not do that. We don't know. These are just estimates. You know, don't sue us. The CAFRs, by contrast, are what they actually did. The CAFRs are essentially the equivalent of, oh, by the way, here's what we actually did. We actually spend a lot more, or sometimes a lot less, depending, on this specific activity, and this is actually what happened. That's like, whoa. So now, remember when we were talking about the driver licensure, there was the issue about the VACS, the Vernon's Annotated Civil Statutes, versus the actual Texas Transportation Code, because of what happened in 1995. So now you have like two versions of something, of what is supposed to be one thing. Well, with this financial stuff, you now have something similar in one sense. You have the so-called budgets, which are the estimates, and then you have the CAFRs, which is actually what the government actually did, but almost nobody likes to talk about it. So now you have to like, oh, God. So what I'm trying to say here, folks, is that even regardless of the specific type of subject matter you're trying to do research on, it doesn't have to be right to travel like we're talking about tonight. It could be anything. If you're trying to find like the original, what the revisers in Texas called the source law, which is what the legislature actually did, or you're trying to find like the actual real money flows, which is what the CAFRs are, if you didn't know which piece of evidence, which is the correct source of information straight from the government, you might instead look only at the TTC or only at the budgets and think that was the truth, when in fact you also need to look at the VACS for the one and the CAFRs for the other. So there's also an issue here of, even when you're doing your legal, or in this case financial, research, what is the
it's really easy to make a mistake, it would seem.
It's all too easy. But then if you put social engineering and propaganda on top of it, and that's more soft power, not hard power, to be fair, where you're only supposed to look at the budgets and you're only supposed to look at the statutory code instead of the actual enabling statutes, which is what the VACS is, or the CAFRs, which is what the government actually spent taxpayer money on, then you might be coming away with erroneous conclusions. Now, to be fair, Shane, sometimes everything does line up and sometimes the truth is being told sometimes, but not 100%. Again, like with the driver licensure, remember there was the whole difference about the chauffeur's license versus the operator's license. There was that slow erosion, right? They kept expanding. But if I didn't look in the VACS, I wouldn't even know that. And something similar here with the CAFRs.
Okay.
CAFRs, here's the issue. Here's what actually happened. And I don't talk about the budgets because they're worthless. The CAFRs are what matter. So the State Highway Fund in fiscal year 2015, and this is in the CAFR for TxDOT, just more in general, the State Highway Fund had a total revenue of $5.8 billion with a B, not a T, not an M, a B, $5.8 billion. But that was the total revenue. The total expenditures were $7.9 billion. Deficit spending much? But why? How is this possible? This isn't the federal government. They don't have a central. The Texas government doesn't have a central bank like the Federal Reserve to rely on for inflation and debt. How can they? How could the state government, the Texas government, engage in deficit spending and not go bankrupt? Again, they don't have a central bank to rely upon. You know this. So how do they do it? I'll tell you how they did it. The deficit spending was only possible because the fund, $1 billion that was already pre-existing. So think of it this way. You have, and people who are like investment type people where they understand like making investments, they can appreciate that, especially anybody pursuing financially independent early retirement can appreciate this, especially if they're doing the intensive saving type method. Let me put it this way. The deficit spending in the State Highway Fund in 2015 was only possible because there was money that was pre-existing that was already there. So they figured, hey, we can spend more than we earn. So kind of eating away at that accumulated capital. You've read Ludwig von Mises' Human Actions. So you understand some things about capital, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
So basically, there was that pre-existing capital, and they figured, okay, we can do some deficit spending and eat away at that accumulated capital at least this year. Maybe we won't next year. I don't know. I can only tell you what they did in 2015. So let's look at the CAFR for the Texas Mobility Fund. Now, that fund had a total revenue of $392 million. Now, remember, it's a revolving fund, so the amounts are going to be lower. It had a total revenue of $392 million, yet the total expenditures were $536 million. So wait, $392 versus $536. Wait a minute, that's deficit spending, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So wait, well, hold on. I'll tell you the answer. It's going to sound really familiar. The fund's balance was well in excess of $1 billion. So they did.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So you see what happened here. Why do you think I think there's embezzlement going on, even if it's legalized embezzling? Again, some lawyer would have to figure this out. I'm not a lawyer. But you can see just from looking.
So the Texas Mobility Fund, they could literally, deficit spend for probably quite a long time. Based off of the revenue and expenditures in the fiscal year 2015.
And again, if you go by the Austrian understanding of capital, all that, you can kind of understand where they can just eat it. Now, they can't do it indefinitely because there's an endpoint. If they kept doing that, they didn't change anything. But you can see where they have some, let me put it this way, financial cush. Ooh, there's a concept. So Yeah. Oh, I love these excuses over the years too. Just as a side note of, oh, we're running out of money. Give us more money. We're gonna have to jack up taxes or do something else. Or it's like, BS, bull, complete bull. Look at the fund balances, but nobody wants to read the CAFRs. Now let's get a little into the fees. But I'll just say this in passing. The vehicle registration fees go into the State Highway Fund. And but they don't really get allocated for transportation too much. So they're going to pay for other things. Okay, so when you people think that, oh, I'll pay the fees for the vehicle registration and the driver's license and the emissions inspection, it'll go towards the roads, right? Because it's public roads, right? Actually, no. Some of it does, kind of, but then it gets eaten away and eaten away and eaten away. So the kind of the question is, what's going on here? Well, Shane, I think you've heard this term before, but hey, let's mention it here because it's relevant. Okay, Patriot Movement's worried about the federal government. Well, for once, the federal government is actually involved here. Little thing called green mail. Mm-hmm, sure is. I guess we could define green mail as being the public policy of the federal government using the congressional power of the purse against the member states of the union by granting subsidies that are earmarked for specific purposes. So federal aid subsidies much?
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
So people can, on their own time, kind of go through this article and really look at the numbers and such. There is one thing I did want to read verbatim before we keep going, and this is kind of setting the stage for some other things. There was a political scientist by the name of Gary Halter, and he wrote a book called textbook called Government and Politics of Texas, A Comparative View. And I think this quote is rather apropos and a nice segue into kind of what we're going to get into. Quote, although there is much discussion about reducing government at all levels, and there are a few who advocate the abolition of government altogether, governments exist and provide services for very practical reasons. Governments provide a service when it is not practical to exclude people for non-payment and the
socialism.
Exactly. And the use, yeah, like it isn't already happening with all everything else I just described, right? And the use of a service does not exhaust others' ability to use the service. Some government services are provided without charge because there is a benefit to society as a whole, a collective benefit. Without government involvement, the collective benefit would not exist. Close quote.
Good. Good. What's the bad side of this here?
Well, but we need to have a collective benefit, Shane. See, a political scientist by the name of Gary Halter said so in his political science textbook. It must be true.
And
that textbook was about Texas government specifically. And so, okay, sounds like public goods, isn't it? Mm-hmm.
For sure.
And then there's all those kind of issues related to that I'm sure different economists can kind of point at. So one more thing related to this, and then we'll get on to everything else just for purposes of time. This is rather important. So I guess there's a question. Are public roads truly worth the financial costs? Remember what Halter just said? Collective benefit, right? Oh my God, collective benefit. All right, well, let's talk about the collective benefit. Shall we, for once, please? Let's have some transparency here. That's all I ask.
Let's give her a go.
Okay, then. Remember what I said earlier. The vehicle registration, driver's licensure, and emissions inspection fees, some are kind of getting to the State Highway Fund and Texas Mobility Funds, respectively. And some of that is actually going for the roads. Some of it. Okay, but not all of it. So here's the other question. What makes up the non-road expenditures from those two funds? Think about it. Where's the money going, right? So taxpayer money, public monies, public lands, public roads. Where's it going? I'll tell you. The State Highway Fund spent only $3.2 billion on transportation costs this past fiscal year. An additional $4.6 billion, so more, was spent on a combination of, here's the list, capital outlays, the principal on pass-through tolls, and other, quote, other financial fees, close quote. I don't know what those other financial fees are, but that's what it said in the line item on the damn ledger spreadsheet thing in the CAFRs. Now, similarly, the Texas Mobility Fund spent only $147 million on actual transportation, like road stuff and all that, what it's supposed to be for, right? Now, an additional $388 million, let's see, 388 is more than 147, right?
Oh, yeah.
$388 million was spent on capital outlays, both the principal and interest on state bonds, and you'll love this, as well as, quote, other financing fees, close quote.
And other financing fees do include, personal piggy banks for some of these folks, but allegedly, not a guarantee.
So what I'm trying to say here is that for these constitutionally enumerated road funds, these two, most of the money, the majority of the money, this is a democracy, majority rule, right? Well, let's talk about majorities. The majority of the money is not going towards the damn public roads. That is a fact. I would encourage everybody listening to please go click, click, click in that article, pull up the CAFRs. And if you don't like the excerpts that are provided in the Right to Travel bibliography, do your own follow-up and get the CAFRs from either TxDOT and or the Texas Comptroller and double check and run the numbers. Make sure I didn't make a mistake or something. Please, I would encourage people to do that. This is important. You are affected by this, especially if you live in Texas.
Indeed, indeed, yeah. So that was quite a journey through the various infringements. Still got quite a bit to get through. Any closing thoughts on that before we move forward?
Let's just keep going. I mean, this is, as you can kind of see, and I'm trying to stay as calm as I can, but it's that long train of abuses and usurpations leading inexorably to absolute despotism, like Mr. Jefferson said. I guess maybe that's why I'm getting riled up. So I'll try and calm down here so people can focus or whatever. But please keep the Declaration of Independence in mind.
Oh, yeah. I think your frustration is definitely justified. And yeah, it's definitely frustrating here for me as well. But, just kind of look at some of this stuff and just chuckle that people actually, believe that these things are, in their best interest. And,
It's the laws. The last thing I'll say on this, this is actually their own laws. So people who say we need government for roads, we need government for all these 20 million different things. It's like, okay, well, shouldn't you people who advocate and like this stuff, shouldn't you even just do a bare minimum of just comprehending what it is you're friggin' supporting? I'm not saying you have to change your mind and agree with me. I'm just saying, can we have some clarity? Can we have some transparency about what the hell is actually, truly, objectively happening here? That's all I'm saying. Honesty.
All right, so Kyle, part two, extra-constitutional, the name of the series and all, versus constitutional. I'm sure some out there are wondering, you mentioned, constitutionality of, the two road funds. What about the rest of this stuff? Are these right to travel infringements unconstitutional per se?
I think with maybe some very few exceptions regarding some particular points of law that I go into more detail than in the articles, but I would prefer to just let people read that because there's some minutia in there that I think is better if people just read it. I would say, generally speaking, the right to travel infringements, as I've explained them in quite some detail here, are rather extra constitutional. Let me try to kind of define here, like I wrote about in the concluding article, extra constitutional number 7, do you have the right to travel? Essentially, that which is unconstitutional breaks or violates the letter of the law, right? It's just clearly, they just roll right over you, right? But when you have a vagueness, when you have a opening where there's not like a specific prohibition against the government from doing something, or you could also say maybe something more like color of law, perhaps. I don't know, maybe lawyers should debate that point. I would suggest there might be a kind of a, I don't want to say intermediate, but let's just say a arguably shade of gray type thing that would be extra constitutional. Let me get a little bit more precise, so maybe it's not shade of gray. Let's put it this way. There's the letter of the law and the spirit of the law, right? The letter of the law is like what the black letter law is, what it actually, the actual English words mean literally, right? Then there's the spirit of the law. The spirit is the meaning or the intent or what's implied, what would be vernacularly described as, say, reading between the lines. I'm sure you've heard that.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely.
Okay. So since that is indeed the case, what if the public servants who did want to perpetuate a tyranny upon the people knew the people were sensitive to tyrannical acts that were clearly unconstitutional, but they still want to perpetuate tyranny, but they didn't want to go to the obvious of being unconstitutional, of breaking the letter of the law? What if, perhaps, and this is the diabolical part of it, what if they were able to keep the letter of the law but they were also somehow able to simultaneously violate the spirit of the law. Ah, see that little shimmying action going on there, like doing the little limbo, little lawyer limbo. Mm-hmm. And
could this be similar? I don't remember what reference it was specifically, but it was via common law where the judiciary kind of, you know, just ruled on court cases, and that was kind of the result. I think it was, I don't remember which one it was specifically. Would that kind
yeah,
of
the tra- the traffic
you know,
stops.
The extra constitutional?
I mean, the traffic stops article.
Yeah, the traffic stops. Yeah.
Well, I think maybe other lawyers should maybe try and debate that, and I wish they would, or if not debate, at least explain it to the people, or maybe correct me if my reasoning was wrong. But yeah, I mean, think about that. What they actually did. I'll say one more time so this is clear. The Constitution says probable cause for warrants, but what the CCA did was that they created this brand new legal standard of reasonable suspicion as an end run around probable cause so that warrantless searches could occur. Now the question is, did that break the letter of the law, which is Article 1, Section 9, I believe, where it says, you have to have probable cause and get a warrant. Otherwise, it's an unreasonable search or seizure, which is prohibited by the Bill of Rights, by the Texas Bill of Rights. Okay. That's what the black letter law, that is what the letter of the law says. Now, the question is, does the reasonable suspicion break that, clearly break that? I personally think it probably does, or at least comes close. Or perhaps more insidiously, maybe it doesn't necessarily break it, but it's an end run around it. It's a circumvention. It is violating the spirit of Article 1, Section 9, that Fourth Amendment equivalent right here in Texas. It's a circumvention, an end run. It violates the spirit of the law, but it may not actually break it. And since that may very well be the case, I want to leave the door open for other people to at least kind of debate that on their own time, with people perhaps smarter than I am or more knowledgeable, at least, especially those in the legal profession, licensed to practice law and all of that, which is its own fun issue. Is it an end run? Is it a spirit of the law, but they're violating the spirit but keeping the letter? Or is it outright breaking the letter? And so, again, just to say this one more time, if it's unconstitutional, you're breaking the letter of the law, period. No issue. If it's violating the spirit, but you're keeping the letter of the law, I'm saying that would probably be better described as extra constitutional. And so when you look at your driver, again, let's go down the list, the infringements. You have your driver licensure, your vehicle registration, your emissions inspections, the liability certification more generally, your traffic stops, and your general funding. Maybe some of those are unconstitutional. Perhaps, and I want to leave the door open to that, but I'm simply saying, what if it's more insidious? What if instead the limited government that was supposed to be limited wasn't actually limited because the lawyers and the bureaucrats were clever and cunning enough to figure out how to do an end run where they weren't actually breaking the law at all, but they found gaps. They found, you see where I'm going with this, they found loopholes and they exploited them.
Are the government's using legal interstices?
But doing it in a way not in terms of protecting human liberty, but as a way of promoting tyranny and growing government, making it big government. You're correct in the sense.
So it's a double-edged sword. Legal interstices are kind of a double-edged sword.
That would be one way of conceiving of it. Sure, there's a term called legal opportunism. There's also a term called legal abuse. There's actually different Wikipedia pages, and I would suggest people may want to look up some of those Wikipedia pages. And at some point, I do want to write an article trying to kind of simplify that stuff, because now we're getting more into fundamentals, not so much right to travel so much. But you see where I'm going with this. You see where there's kind of like a deeper issue regarding the legal system itself right here in Texas. Not the federal government, but Texas government, where maybe, the Texas Bill of Rights and the Texas Constitution more generally did not actually protect us from these infringements, from this crap. That maybe it was insufficient, if indeed it is correct to reason out that maybe the letter of the law wasn't broken, but gaps were there that then these later tyrants, lawyers, bureaucrats, and others, even legislators, right? Like the Texas legislature passing stuff into the VACS, of course. And the judges and the judiciary regarding the traffic stops and all that stuff I just explained, maybe they were just exploiting. And what I really would encourage people to do is to really sit down and think, and also read, please read the series. So you get the full context and the full data and all the facts that I was able to discover. Because this is original research to my knowledge. I don't think anybody's even written about this before. I'm probably the very first guy down this trail, at least that I know of. And please get, you know, talk about this stuff, figure this stuff out. You don't, well, I'll say this one more time. You don't have to agree with me. Just look at the facts and make sense of it for yourself. And as far as my own observations go, take it with a grain of salt. I don't have all this stuff figured out. I'm just simply a common man trying not to be ignorant of the law as per that legal maxim. Ignorantia juris non excusat. And I can't figure it out in its entirety, but some things I have at least a general, perhaps vague idea of.
I know you mentioned before that you're working on some material concerning lawfare. Would you say that the Texas government is waging lawfare against Texans?
Yes, absolutely. Whether it be truly unconstitutional or, as I suspect, it might be, may very well be, or at least some of it is, extra-constitutional, violating the spirit of the law without breaking it, then, I mean, either way, they're both forms of lawfare. And let me just provide a working definition. And again, I don't have this all figured out, and I do want to write an article at this on some point in the future, you know, barring an act of God, of course. Or would that be an act of state? Would be simply this. A working definition that I'm going by regarding lawfare, because the neoconservatives have a very different notion of lawfare where they're blaming Muslims for random stuff, which doesn't make any sense, is simply this. When public servants, government agents, government employees use the government's own monopoly laws to infringe upon the natural liberties of the American citizenry. That's the working definition I'm going by in terms of lawfare. Again, it's a neologism of law and warfare. Law, warfare, lawfare, the use of law as a weapon of war. And it's kind of like, I don't want to say the nicer version of, but it's not as harsh as democide, but it's on that same tyrannical spectrum. So they may not kill you dead, like with democide, but, you know, they might, you know, steal your home and, you know, make you
toss you in a dungeon.
The political prisoners are also part of that too. And at some point I want to write a little bit more about the political prisoner situation too, because that people are still in denial about the existence of political prisoners. Different topic for another time. But regarding right to travel and regarding why, whether it's unconstitutional or at least in part, if not mostly extra constitutional, exploiting those gaps in the law in order to infringe on our freedoms and so forth. It's lawfare. We're in trouble. We're in tyranny. We're in deep, deep tyranny.
Indeed. Yeah, I would definitely agree. So I had one final question, and we kind of already mentioned this, so I'll just kind of run through this quickly. The question is the federal government involved in these right to travel infringements? Well, for the most part, no, not involved. The only, you know, instances of green mail, the federal funding and the previous, you know, the EPA and the emissions inspections, but they're, you know, kind of out of it's been turned over to Texas now. Is federal government involved? No, definitely not. And I will say, Kyle, and this kind of relates here, I tend to listen to, I don't know why. I used to listen to music in the car when I was running errands and things. But now, you know, I turn on local talk radio, you know, the conservative variety. Uh-oh. And, you know, it was actually, you know, all of it, like, you know, the major ones, like, you know, your Mark Levin and Rush Limboner, like their shows are like exactly the same. Like it, that's just how it is. But there was a local guy here who actually said the government closest to you is the one that matters most, the one that can do the most damage to you. And you know, it's kind of refreshing to hear that over local talk radio. So and that definitely kind of relates here. Yeah, in Texas, yeah, definitely it's the state doing this to you. It's not the federal government. Not
right.
The federal government doesn't do a ton of terrible shit, but in this instance, this example that we're kind of discussing tonight is not the federal
government. And to support that too, what that correct idea that guy had you made, there's also the fictional line from that Mel Gibson movie called The Patriot, and I'll paraphrase a little bit here, but it was the idea of, why should I trade one tyrant 3,000 miles away for 3,000 tyrants 1 mile away? And me personally, yep. I'm more, you know, that we all have to have priorities, right? There's grievances, you know, there's grievances and then there's grievances. And in terms of, you know, making priorities, I would worry more about the 3,000 tyrants 1 mile away. So that's just me.
For sure.
Again, I'm not saying that we shouldn't be worried about other grievances involving the federal government, like the imperialistic wars of aggression who murder foreigners who have caused us no harm and other things. again, you had me on, first time you had me on was for dragnet wiretapping. That was all about the National Security Agency, which I still want to have abolished. So that doesn't change. All I'm saying is that the federal government is not the be-all and end-all of every political grievance that's actually real and provable. There are other governments involved perpetuating lawfare in some way, shape, or form, and even committing democide. I mean, hell, even when the police, a lot of times at these traffic stops, when they just get out and friggin' just murder somebody, even if they're caught on tape, well, that was democide. But was the federal government involved? In those particular cases, I remember the Black Lives Matter people back when they were popular. I don't think they are anymore necessarily. But whenever they would complain about so-called police brutality, but really democide was the important one. I couldn't find an FBI agent anywhere. Did you see a DEA narc? I can't find an IRS agent anywhere. No, it was these either municipal state trooper or like county sheriff's deputies types that were for the most part doing this type of stuff. Last time I checked, the FBI doesn't do traffic stops, folks. Okay, federal government isn't the be-all and end-all of tyranny here in America. You have to worry about the several state governments too. Again, that's why I'm a little bit suspicious of when people start promoting, you know, 10th Amendment, 10th Amendment. And it's like, I know that comes from a good place, but can you not focus so much on legalities and focus more on practicality when it comes to doing like actual activist stuff? I know, I'm just saying.
LibertyUnderAttack.com